had been sprinkled as a baby myself. When the time did come and I chose to be baptized, to get immersed, that's when the Holy Spirit began to really work in my life. And eventually God pulled me into campus ministry as my career. Because of my personal history, making the good news clear to others is one of the most important things to me. One of the things I'm most passionate about, since it was not clear to me growing up. So maybe about 4 or 5 years into ministry here, a student came along who grew up in a tradition that sprinkled infants, and we met together and just went, reviewed the gospel. We looked at what the Bible teaches about baptism and making that response herself, and it was just like I'd done with several dozen other students at the time, but she was pretty adamant about sticking with her church tradition, and all I can do is point to the Bible, and that's her choice. But a little bit down the road, this student asked if she could lead a His House life group on the topic of evangelism. Normally, under normal circumstances, I would be thrilled about that. But she wasn't on the same page about how the Bible tells us to respond to God's offer. So we had another conversation about that. She was sticking to her tradition. So I had to say no to the small group. I'm not going to give a thumbs up to something that's going to confuse a topic that God's made me passionate about making clear. So my answer seemed very straightforward and logical and reasonable and not mean in any way. Just kind of talked through that. But instead of her choosing to research it again and consider changing her mind or trying to change my mind, instead of staying connected and choosing to agree to disagree, instead of leaving His House altogether, she chose to stay involved in His House, but decided to personally reject me. She would sit at the back, doing her own thing during the message, including her own side conversations. She spread lies among other His House members about what I told her. She basically ignored my presence. Like, if she was sitting at a booth with a few other students during the week sometime, and I walked up to the table, everyone at the table would interact with me, but she would not even look up and acknowledge that I was standing there. If I directly used her name and asked her how she was doing, she might say flatly, "Fine," and then immediately start talking to someone else at the table or get up and leave the table abruptly. That sabotaged my confidence as a campus minister, as a person. To be honest, I was a bit gun-shy about making the gospel clear to students for the next year or two after that. It sucks to be rejected. This is not part of my story that I like to share often, but I want you to know that being a campus minister doesn't make me immune to the fear of rejection, or even to church hurt. I truly hope that you've never experienced a level of personal rejection like that before, but if you have, I'm truly sorry and want you to know that I get it. So it's easy to let the fear of rejection hold us back. Now, I think Satan likes to cash in on that temptation a lot, especially when it has to do with an opportunity for us to be bold with our faith. I did eventually step back into confidence about proclaiming the gospel clearly, but back at the time, I had tried to keep it contained and tried to handle it all myself, which made the healing really slow going. So tonight we're going to look at some things, learn some things from the Apostle John and his friends that can help us have confidence in Christ, confidence about sharing him, help us even expect some rejection here and there, and give us an idea of what to do when that happens ahead of time. So we're in a series called John, Love and Thunder. The Apostle John came to see himself as the disciple whom Jesus loved, despite having some thunder in his backstory. So we're going to start John's story tonight with a passage he wrote near the end of his life. kind of like a frame story. We'll start with the end, and then we'll flash back to see how he got there. So please turn to the letter of 1 John chapter 1. That's 1 John is one of the small books at the end of the Bible, end of the New Testament. So 1 John chapter 1, verses 1 through 4. And this is ESV. It's a little bit wordy, but I'm going to try to read it in a rhythm that'll make sense. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we looked upon and have touched with our hands, concerning the word of life. He's talking about Jesus. The life was made manifest, and we have seen it and testify to it, proclaim to you the eternal life, which was with the Father and was made manifest to us. That which we have seen and heard, we proclaim also to you, so that you too may have fellowship with us. And indeed, our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. And we are writing these things so that our joy may be complete. So John opens his first epistle, his first letter, very reminiscent of the way he started the book of John, or the Gospel of John. He talks about the word of life, Jesus, who was there at the beginning, who was revealed in the flesh, and whom John knew firsthand, personally, face to face. John speaks openly about testifying about Jesus and proclaiming the gospel. He's very bold and very confident. He's bold with that message so that when we hear that and receive that eternal life, we can be in fellowship with one another. We can be in fellowship with God. He writes about so that our joy may be complete together. So complete joy, if you can imagine that. Sounds like an entirely positive experience from that little bit. If we only had that passage to work with, we might conclude that everything about speaking up for Jesus will be fun and positive. Like, you know, when we're bold, everyone will always say yes, and it'll just be a pleasant experience, and our joy will just be full. That sounds great, John, but what if? What if we try to be bold like you and it doesn't go so well? What if we get rejected? Now, John doesn't acknowledge the possibility of rejection. I mean, it's just a small paragraph, so it doesn't cover everything. But we might conclude that he's hiding that rejection part. But John was an old man at this point. He didn't have any reason or pretense. We might guess that John just lived his life in a bubble. Of course, he saw Jesus being rejected. But maybe John didn't have much personal rejection. Maybe God just made it easy for them and completely cleared the path before them and made it easy and fun to be bold for Jesus. But if you were here earlier this semester, you might remember a story from when we focused on the thunder part of Love and Thunder. John actually had a really hard time with rejection. You might remember that when a Samaritan village rejected them, John was so angry, he asked Jesus if he could call fire down from heaven and destroy the entire village. Thankfully, Jesus said no and rebuked John for his request. So how did John get from there to boldly proclaiming Jesus with cheerfulness, seemingly free of the fear of rejection? So let's flash back 60-some years before John wrote this letter, take a look at a couple experiences that he had. So turn to the other end of the New Testament, to Matthew chapter 10. It's about a third backward in your Bible. Matthew 10, verses 2 through 5. So the names of the 12 apostles are these. First, Simon, who is called Peter, Andrew, his brother, James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew the tax collector, James the son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus, Simon the zealot, and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. So this story isn't unique to John. It applied to all 12 of the apostles, but I think this is a big stepping point in John's story. So verse 5, these 12 Jesus sent out, instructing them, go nowhere among the Gentiles and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. So So a little tangent, why was that? Simply put, the promise of the Messiah came through the Jews, came through their lineage, their holy scriptures, so it made sense that the first ones to hear the good news about the Messiah, their Messiah, that they would be the ones to hear that before extending that to the rest of the world. So verse 7, Jesus told them to proclaim as you go, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Now, those weren't the only words they used, obviously. It wasn't a chant. There's some parallel passages in Mark 6 and Luke 9. And the Luke 9, 6 passage specifies they were sharing the gospel. So when they were proclaiming the kingdom of God, what they were doing was sharing the gospel. So when we proclaim something versus just saying something, we're saying, this is official. This is public. This is important. We're not just timidly muttering something under our breath. We're not trailing off in volume. When we proclaim something, we're broadcasting it like a herald of old. Herald with a H-E, not an H-A. Speaking up, being bold and confident in what we're saying. That's what Jesus instructed them. Proclaim the kingdom of heaven. They had watched Jesus do that, and now it was their turn. He was sending them out. He wasn't going to be there to do the speaking this time. So being bold was kind of built into Jesus' instructions and assignment for them. And it is built in for us too. You can keep your Bible in Matthew 10, but we're going to look at something the Apostle Paul wrote in Romans 10, verses 14 and 15. That one's up on the screen. How then will they call on him whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in him of they have never heard? And how are they to hear without someone preaching? How are they to preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the good news. So Paul's sending the message to us. If we want other people to hear about the gospel, we need to tell them. It's not going to happen through osmosis. We need to tell them. So consider yourself sent. He talked about people being sent to do that. So we should confidently proclaim it like that herald of old, that messenger bringing the good news and proclaiming it. So the basic instruction here is proclaim your faith with confidence. Proclaim your faith with confidence. That's the goal of what we're talking about tonight. But now we're gonna focus on the courage to actually do that. So back to Matthew chapter 10, verse 8, Jesus continued, heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse lepers, cast out demons. So Jesus gave them power and authority to perform these signs to authenticate this gospel message that was starting to spread. And continuing in verse 8, you received without paying, give without pay. Acquire no gold or silver or copper for your belts, no bag for your journey, or two tunics or sandals or a staff, for the laborer deserves his food. So Jesus gives the 12 this message to proclaim, the authority to authenticate that it's really from God. He instills a lot of reasons to be bold here, but then he kind of puts them in this vulnerable position. He basically tells them, only take the clothes on your back. This was not a one-day trip. This was a walking journey covering multiple destinations around Israel. So I think if Heather's mom would have received that instruction, she might have had a little panic attack or something. She brings three large coats, tote bags, and a cooler to the beach just for a couple hours. But Jesus said, take nothing but the clothes you're wearing. Jesus tells the 12, go proclaim the kingdom. I'm going to give you power to heal, to cast out demons, but you're going to have to trust me completely for your provision. So imagine that. Put yourself in Paul's shoes, or put yourself in John's shoes. I may have a a little fear of the potential rejection about proclaiming the message. But now, I'm not really worried about being bold for the kingdom. Now, if I'm worried about, am I going to eat? Am I going to have shelter overnight? Now, if I'm rejected, I've got a bigger personal stake in this. So how do we proceed from there? What if Jesus's narrowing here is part of the key? So relying on Jesus in other areas can help us trust him in our boldness. Relying on Jesus in other areas can help us trust him in our boldness. And I think in the 21st century American church culture, it's a fair question to ask, am I currently relying on Jesus for anything in my life? Am I currently relying on Jesus for anything in my life? Sometimes we're put into a situation where we're kind of forced to rely on Jesus, maybe because of finances, maybe because of health, or our world's flipped upside down with a class that went awry or a relationship that went the wrong direction. But when things are pretty okay, am I relying on Jesus for anything? And if you're thinking about that and there's not an immediate answer of yes in any specific way, let me suggest how we can build some reliance on him when we're tempted to think that we currently don't really need to. So it's a little bit tangent to the topic, but I thought this would be helpful and practical. Here's three suggestions for relying on Jesus. One, develop a habit of fasting. Develop a habit of fasting. When I fast, if I do that as a regular habit, I'm relying on God to give me spiritual nourishment in place of the physical nourishment that my body's craving. Second, trust him with your generosity. Trust him with your generosity. If I have a regular habit of giving a percentage of my income, let's say it's 10%, if I'm giving God 10% regularly of my income, I'm trusting him, I'm relying on him to do as much or more with my 90% than I could do with the 100%. Third, pray consistently for God to do something only he could do. Pray consistently for God to do something only he could do. If my prayer life consists of things that could happen by circumstance anyways, or things that I could control anyway, there's not really any reliance on God in those prayers. So ask him to do something only he could do. For example, praying for someone that you want to know Jesus who you don't think is going to. That would be a great example of that, and regularly praying for that person. So back to Matthew 10, verse 11. Whatever town or village you enter, find out who is worthy in it and stay there until you depart. As you enter the house, greet it. If your house is worthy, let your peace come upon it. If it's not worthy, let your peace return to you. Gotta be honest, I've never walked into a house and said, let alone thought, peace be to this house. Maybe I should start though. But it was an attitude of blessing. It wasn't just a blanket blessing to cover everywhere they went and all the people they came across. It was strategic blessing that was tentative. Extend your peace here. Extend your shalom, your health, your wholeness. Extend your trust here. Offering it right off the bat. And if it turns out that it is a worthy place or a worthy person, great, you've got a head start on the relationship. But if that particular situation or person starts to show that it's not a worthy place, instead of getting angry, instead of collapsing into a pile of mush, instead of withholding our trust from everybody, let your peace return to you, and then you have it again to offer somewhere else that is worthy. We could definitely apply this to so many everyday life situations, but remember, this was written in the context of the 12 apostles being bold with their faith and us learning from their example. So as we seek to further break the fear of rejection, try this. Offer your peace and trust tentatively from the beginning. Offer your peace and trust tentatively from the beginning. Instead of waiting for people to earn your trust, wait for them to break it. And if they do, take it back and give it somewhere else. Jesus continues about what if this is not a worthy place. Verse 14. If anyone will not receive you or listen to your words, shake off the dust from your feet when you leave the house or town. Truly I say to you, it will be more bearable on the day of judgment for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah than for that town. So notice that Jesus said house or town. That means some of the places that they would be going might not just have like one jerk family that rejects them. It might be the whole town. Yet, if their peace returned to them, they can bring it back out at the next town. Jesus also told them that when they're rejected, to shake the dust off their feet. Now, of course, we live in a different culture today. That might seem really weird and awkward to just start kicking the air on your way out. It might not be very effective as far as cleanliness either, but what it symbolized was an attitude that none of the harm or insults that they intended is going to stick to me. Not even the dust of your floor will stick to me, let alone your rejection. It's that attitude. So just like your peace can return to you, their rejection can return to them. Just like your peace can return to you, their rejection can return to them. And don't let it stick. It's not a retaliation. It's just not letting it stick. One more detail about this mission trip that Jesus sent them on. In Mark's account, in Mark 6:7, it includes the detail that Jesus sent the 12 out in twos. He sent them out two by two. So they were not all alone in this mission. They had a friend there. Each of them had a friend there to be bold for Jesus with them and to help one another deflect those rejections together. So as you are bold for Jesus, bring a friend in on it to encourage one another. As you're bold for Jesus, bring a friend in on it to encourage one another. It's just a simple little narrative in Matthew 10, but it lays out a great strategy for us to be bold in our faith and to effectively handle rejection when it does come our way. Now, unfortunately, according to Luke's chronology, John's temper of wanting to fire to come down and burn up the Samaritan town, that apparently happened right after this mission trip, like right after they got back. So these principles were still working their way into John, but to be fair, he didn't have the Holy Spirit in him at that time. But after he did, he was locked in. So look over at chapter 4, but I'm going to summarize 3 and 4. It's a story about John and Peter. They're on their way to a prayer meeting at the temple in Jerusalem. And they stopped at the temple gate to heal this lame beggar so that he could walk again. And it was a miracle, and there were people around watching and saw that, and they used this opportunity to tell everyone who witnessed it about faith in Jesus. And because they were teaching things that the religious leaders didn't really like, they had John and Peter arrested and kept in custody overnight until they would be questioned the next day. So when that time came and they were given the opportunity to speak, they were bold again about their faith in Jesus. And since the man whom they had healed was standing right there with them, the religious leaders didn't know how to punish them. So they commanded them, don't teach in the name of Jesus anymore, which John and Peter completely ignored. But when John and Peter were released, they grabbed their friends and had a prayer meeting again. Did they pray about, whew, that was a close call? or ask God for his protection against future rejections? No, that's not what they prayed at all. So let's read that, Acts 4, verses 29 through 31. Acts 4, 29 through 31. And now, Lord, this is their prayer, look upon their hearts and grant to your servants to continue to speak your word in all boldness, while you stretch out your hand to heal, and signs and wonders are performed through the name of your holy servant Jesus. And when they had prayed, the place in which they were gathered together was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and continued to speak the word of God with boldness. You know, I would really love to be part of a prayer meeting that shook because God was moving so much. You know, maybe John was a slow starter in learning how to deal with rejection as he was learning how to be bold with his faith. And that's okay that he was a slow starter, because that helps us give grace to ourselves as we're learning to navigate through that. The point is that those instructions from Jesus did work their way into John, and he got there, and we can too. So let's fast forward those 60-some years to that passage we started with. 1 John chapter 1, verses 1 through 4. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon and have touched with our hands, concerning the word of life. The life was made manifest, and we have seen it and testified to it and proclaimed to you the eternal life, which was with the Father and was made manifest to us. That which we have seen and heard, we proclaim also to you, so that you too may have fellowship with us, and indeed our fellowship is with the Father, with his Son, Jesus Christ. And we are writing these things so that our joy may be complete. John didn't write this from a place of being oblivious to rejection or of ignoring it. Rather, he traveled through it and worked through it to the point where he was simply going to be bold for Jesus no matter what. That fear of rejection, the anger and hurt he had from it, that he'd been through it, just didn't impact him anymore like it used to. The dust doesn't stick to him anymore. His peace returns to him, and all he sees is the potential ahead for that shared fellowship and joy with new members of the body. So what about our boldness? What do we do? Step one might be as simple as starting a spiritual conversation with someone. You don't have to know where it goes. Just start it and see what happens. You don't have to know everything. Share what you're at. Share what you're learning. And if you get to the point of someone else wanting to learn the gospel, what it means to become a Christian and to grow as a Christian, chapter 2 from our discipleship workbook goes through that. If you have one of those, you can always refer back to that as a reference. If you don't, any of the staff and many of our leaders would be happy to sit down with you one-on-one and go through that gospel template for the purpose of leaving you with a tool and a resource to be able to share that with the next person, or even to make sure that you're solid with it yourself. You can always print more of those gospel templates from our website. I have that up on the screen, svsu.hhcf.org. That's our normal website, /gospel-template. It's pretty simple. When we have the inspiration to share our faith, our motivation to share our faith, and we start to work through the fear of rejection, I think the rest of it and the how-tos will get worked out as we step into it and step forward. So thinking ahead, what opportunities might there be to share at the fall retreat this weekend? Or if you'll be with family this weekend, what opportunities might there be there? Let me pray. God, I thank you that as you call us to make disciples of all nations, to be bold with the good news about you, you know not everyone's going to accept it, and you prepare us to think about that ahead of time and be ready to know how to handle that. God, I pray you'd give us boldness to speak up more than we think we should in talking about you. God, I pray that there'll be some people who are hungry to hear more, and if others reject the message, God, help us to deflect that and let our peace return to us and keep sharing with other people, not be wounded by that for a long time. So God, we pray for your Holy Spirit to direct us toward who to share that with and give us the courage to step out and try. And we pray that you would move mightily this weekend and in the weeks ahead this semester. God, we thank you. Pray you bless our discussion time now. In Jesus' name, amen. So we will have the worship team come back up for a few songs, but we're going to have some discussion time till